Minister of Tag Team, discussion on area-based management tools and marine protected areas, and then also looking at institutional engagements, which are definitely two very interlinked topics. So we'll start out with the ABMT discussion, providing a quick background, and then going into the science, and then talking a bit about governance. And I have a suspicion that for a lot of the ABMT and MPA discussion, it's going to be like preaching to the choir here. So bear with me as I tell you things that you already know about how great MPAs are. And then we'll talk about institutional arrangements, and specifically the discussion that's been happening within BB&J. So the different approaches, different models for global regional hybrid. We'll briefly touch on this question of not undermining, which has been a hot topic. Different components of those institutional arrangements, brief analysis, and then Kristina will end with how this all works on the ground in terms of implementation.
Smooth.
And so just to ground us, I'm sure Peggy, I'm sorry to have missed your presentation, but I'm sure it was an absolute fabulous overview. And so you all know about the BB&J package and the four different elements there. We will be focusing on this first element of the package, actually technically the second element if you're going in like order of the resolution. But first on my package here is the ABMT, area-based management tools, including marine protected areas. And so what are area-based management tools, you might ask? And there's no official definition of an ABMT. However, early on in the preparatory committee process, the Costa Rican mission collected a whole bunch of different definitions of all kinds of different terms, including ABMTs. And I thought that their definition was really one of the most helpful ones, so I listed it here. And so in really broad strokes, ABMTs are very self-explanatory, right? They are tools used to manage areas. But it's a little bit more difficult, right? And you're like, you just read it backwards and you sort of have the definition. But it's a little bit more difficult to describe exactly what that means on the ground and in practice. And so I find it's really helpful to give a few examples of different types of ABMTs that are considered.
Okay, well, Masha, would you like to describe what EBSAs are?
They're ecologically or biologically significant areas that are essentially a process under the Convention on Biological Diversity, a scientific, robust process that has now sort of established the first generation of areas that are, I think, primarily within national waters that we should place attention on. And it's very important to highlight that parties are very strict on ensuring we understand that this is a purely scientific process that does not necessarily have to have management implications, but in fact, in practice, it often does.
Yeah, and the relevant competent organizations have been requested and invited and pleaded with to adopt measures in order to enhance the protection of these places. But once you get out into the high seas, there's often little response from the relevant competent organization. So it is just a piece of paper. And this little one up here doesn't have the most up-to-date map. There's one for the Northeast Atlantic that was established by the Northwest Atlantic, which is now atop an area that has been contracted out for deep seabed mining exploration for 15 years. So you start to have a little bit of overlap and potential undermining of one thing by the other. Regional fisheries management organizations can adopt with respect to deep sea bottom fishing and potential impacts of deep sea bottom contact gear. They're worried about 10-ton doors, 40-ton doors, on basically vulnerable marine ecosystems. They're generally characterized as corals, sponges, xenophyophores, anything that's actually erect from the sea floor that provides habitat structure and is also slow to recover. And these have been designated at the request of the United Nations General Assembly pursuant to a series of resolutions that said, hey guys, you do have obligations to protect biodiversity in the marine environment. Show us what you're going to do by conducting environmental impact assessments and then managing to avoid significant adverse effects, which is a powerful tool, and it would be great if it were in fact implemented. IMO, particularly sensitive sea areas. Anybody here going to IMO? So PSSAs are sort of like EBSAs in that they're actually telling you that this area is of ecological significance, that they've been recognized by the International Maritime Organization as an area in need of enhanced management. But here you actually have to pick something from the International Maritime Organization toolbox of a routing scheme, a discharge measure, or a reporting system in order to go along with your designation of a PSSA. But again, they have to be adopted by the IMO, and there's none yet in the high seas. And when we worked on the Sargasso Sea, sort of said, wouldn't it be nice? We were told by other governments, don't bother us, we have more important things to do at the International Maritime Organization. So it's a challenge. In the deep sea mining world, they took a different approach because we know so little about the deep sea. They adopted the series of so-called representative areas of particular environmental interest. There'll be an acronym test later. See how much you can remember. And these are actually based on gene flow across the Clarion-Clipperton Zone. This is sort of between Hawaii and California, Mexico. Covers about the size of the U.S., continental U.S. or Europe. It's about 30% that's been put off limits to seabed mining, but on a provisional basis, they're still trying to collect data to say if these are the right areas. And now it's sort of in place. They're thinking, do we need more? How do we protect the valuable stuff that's inside the mining exploration areas? There's no tools yet. Regulations are under development. And they're working on designing systems in other regions, sort of after the fact. These are the protected areas, these are the mining areas. Where do you think the most interesting seabed is? Like where the minerals are, because that's where the sponges and corals and xenobiophores grow. They're now trying to design these systems in the Pacific Triangle, the seamounts there, between the United States and Guam and Marianas in Japan, and then also in the Indian Ocean. These are very complicated processes going on. And then regional seas. OSBAR has a mandate for protecting biodiversity beyond national jurisdiction. They, with their parties, including Norway and Iceland, said we're going to protect these particular areas. They have no mandate to do anything other than request the sectoral organizations to cooperate. They were able to get NIAC, who also had their own science data. These are areas with deep sea corals, so they're protected from deep sea bottom fishing. The boundaries don't actually even overlap, but from nothing else. And nobody else is obliged to follow them. So that you as a regional organization can adopt your MPAs, but if you're from Japan or China, you don't have to follow them because you didn't agree to them in place. And this is part of the problem we have and why we'd like to look to a global system of MPAs.
So for that, we're now going to turn to back to marine protected areas, which are a very important subset of area-based management. And indeed, the ABMT discussion, the prep comms, and at the first IGC meeting, focused a great deal on MPAs specifically. And so, again, we're going to look to how we define MPAs. And like ABMTs, there's no single universally recognized definition for MPAs. The CBD has a definition, the FAO has a definition, we'll go back to that acronym test later, IUCN has a different definition, and then if you look at what scientists say, what different universities say, what different national positions are, it's kind of dizzying. So I just decided to adapt the High Seas Alliance's definition and sort of simplify that, put it up here. So High Seas Alliance stance is that it's a geographically defined marine area where human activities are regulated, managed, or prohibited in order to afford comprehensive protection. And for me, the most important word in this definition is comprehensive. For indeed, it's the MPA's ability to afford comprehensive multi-sector protection that really sets it apart from other area-based management tools. And so again, before I leave terminology, I know we've talked a lot about it, but before we leave, I want to make sure that we sort of have all the boxes fitting in the right other boxes, because especially when you look across different language barriers, the term MPA or marine reserve is sort of used to mean different things. So to clarify how we mean it when we're discussing all of these, marine reserves are a type of marine protected area, and when we talk about them, we're specifically meaning those MPAs that are the most strictly managed and correspondingly offer the highest level of protection. So in short, marine reserves are a type of MPA, specifically the type that offers the strongest protection. And MPAs are a type of ABMT, specifically the type that offers the most comprehensive management. So, all right.
right, so moving on now to, I don't need to spend, I think, probably any time on this. I'm sure Peggy's already covered the threats that are facing the BBNJ. But just to summarize, marine ecosystems, including highly valuable fish species such as tunas and sharks, are under increasing stress due to a multitude of threats. Over exploitation of marine living resources, habitat degradation and destruction, pollution, climate change, the list goes on. And these various stressors in turn lead to depleted populations of economically and culturally important species. They alter community structure, they lead to harmful changes in ecosystem functioning. And just as one example, the FAO report, which was published this most recently this year, found that 93% of fish stocks are either fully or overexploited. And I'm sure many of you in this room focus on fisheries specifically, but for those of you who don't, there are tons of papers that Kristina and I, or many in this room, could circulate around that go into a deeper dive on fisheries specifically and mismanagement there.
Yours are not fully exploited yet,
they're trying their best.
So I'm going to pivot now to the science behind MPAs and some of what science shows are some of the benefits of marine protected areas. And so marine protected areas have this potential to mitigate and even reverse many of the negative impacts of these various threats. And there are a few key benefits of MPAs in general that scientists have identified over the last several decades. And the first is that, you know, we have significantly greater biomass can be expected within marine protected areas compared to non-protected areas. So there was a new meta-analysis that was done just this year, I believe, and it showed that biomass as a whole within marine reserves is on average 670% greater than adjacent unprotected areas and 343% greater than in partially protected MPAs. So again, looking at that difference between marine reserves and then broader categories of MPAs. MPAs can also be expected to have greater density of fish species, larger sizes of individually, and then generally higher biomass, higher biodiversity. And then it's fun to look at graphs, so I've included a graph here. It's actually looking at fish abundance in Australia, but the paper itself was looking at implications globally. So the graph here we see exploited species within a marine reserve in Australia. So you can see fish abundance in that marine reserve increased 25%, while abundance outside the reserve decreased by 33%. Again, just one example to show, this is, I often use this for when I'm doing presentations for government officials, and graphs are nice so that you can see green, good, increase, decrease, bad. So that's, anyway, nice to see, not anything new for you. And so then turning to specifically the benefits of high seas MPAs, because this is one of the criticisms we have, right, is that high seas MPAs are going to be a little bit different than MPAs that we see in coastal waters. So there have been a few studies that have looked specifically at what MPAs in the high seas, what benefits we can expect from those. And so again, we see protecting habitat and species critical to marine life, safeguarding biodiversity, protecting top predators and maintaining ecosystem balance. And then a lot of the more recent papers have really been focusing on this last bullet, which is talking about building resilience to climate change. And I'll focus a little bit more on that and some of those findings there, since these are sort of some of the hot topics that we've been hearing lately. So this is a paper by Callum Roberts, Doug McCauley, and a few other folks talking about sort of some of the climate change mitigation benefits that we can expect from marine protected areas. And I won't, this is very busy graphic here. I won't go over all of those different benefits, but it ranges from, of course, the ones that we expect, like carbon storage and preventing loss of carbon that's already been stored, reduction of human stressors. But they're also talking about, you know, ensuring that you don't have extra, like when you're going fishing, you don't have trawling activities that are mucking up stored carbon that's already stored in the sediment there. Climate change implications for that. And they're also looking at also genetic implications, right, and how marine protected areas promote greater genetic diversity, which is going to be really critical in terms of adapting climate change, the effects of climate change. You see that you have a lot more genetic material, a lot greater chance that you're going to be able to survive and thrive even after the impacts of climate change. That said, MPAs are not a golden bullet that you can just put one there and then it'll solve all of the problems. There are a few key areas and key elements of MPAs that are really critical to ensuring that they reach their full potential. And so that is that, so this is from a paper by Edgar et al., finding that what's really key in terms of the success of MPAs is that they are no-take, that they are well-enforced, that they have been around for a while, they're old. You don't want to have an expectation to see overnight success of an MPA. It takes a few years for you to really see the benefits of it. Larger MPAs, he's found to have greater benefits, and he defines that as being greater than 100 square kilometers. And then, interestingly, isolated by deep water and sand is another key element for the success of MPAs. I would say that much of the high seas, you know, fit a lot of these natural qualifications. I'd also add that networks of MPAs are really important, especially for highly migratory species. And this is because the cumulative amount of time that they spend in protected areas increases if they have a network that's along the migratory path. And these migratory corridors can, MPAs along the corridors can help rebuild ecological communities, increase feeding opportunities. And consequently, highly mobile species may spend longer time in these protected areas, and it would result in an improved growth rate. So MPAs are these incredibly powerful tools for conserving biodiversity, and scientists have called for as much as 30% of the world's oceans to be protected within MPAs. And yet less than 1% of the high seas are protected by MPAs. And why is that? The answer, I think, is largely due to governance of how we govern our oceans. For that, I'll turn to Kristina for the next few slides on background.
Oh, thank you. No acronyms here, I'm sure. Okay, the way this chart is designed is to show that these organizations here that are responsible for managing fisheries, regional fisheries management organizations, shipping, international maritime organization, and mining, ISA, these are the ones that have the powers to adopt regulations. And these over here, which are generally secretary and headquartered by United Nations Environment Program, Convention on Migratory Species, Convention on Biological Diversity, and the Regional Seas Conventions, are the ones who are providing the scientific information that are theoretically, at this point in time, supposed to feed into how these sectoral organizations manage their activities. But the disconnect here is these people have no leverage, they have no clout, and they have no political support oftentimes when they come into the sectoral organizations, because sectoral organizations have slightly different priorities. Even though with the Fish Docks Agreement there is a clear mandate to protect biodiversity in the marine environment, because nobody is really watching what they're doing and each one is controlled by their own overarching convention, they're not really accountable for anybody, and the most economically interested state can basically block progress going forward on the protection of biodiversity or species. Similar to the International Maritime Organization, it's largely the shipping nations that go there, and the International Seabed Authority, it has a very complicated structure, but we're seeing more and more interest in let's get on with this new business of seabed mining, and it's harder and harder to get the idea of conserving for the benefit of humankind listened to. These organizations are trying to advance. CITES is the only one that can actually adopt conservation measures, and I think we need to stay tuned for what their powers are, because they in many ways can help to supplement where the RFMOs are quite weak. Then the World Heritage Convention, some people are interested in, you know, can we actually identify these crown jewels in the high seas and get those protected, and IOC is responsible for ocean science. Anything you want to add?
No, I will go into some of the regional ones in my next slide.
Okay.
So, Kristina did many of the organizations that Kristina just mentioned are global in nature, but of course many of them are also regional in nature, in addition to being sectoral. And so this is a map that our team pulled together a few years ago about the sort of patchwork of organizations that are both sectoral and regional in nature. Which is largely a map of RFMOs, with a handful of regional seas organizations mapped on there as well. And so while it looks like collectively there's a pretty comprehensive coverage, it in reality is pretty patchy. And so those organizations that do have the authority and the tools to carry out some of these conservation measures are limited by sector, So, you know, VMEs to protect fisheries, for example. And they're also protected by, limited by region. And even when these sector-specific tools are utilized, there's generally poor to no coordination with overlapping and neighboring organizations. And so this means that under our current system of government, it's incredibly complicated and challenging to take into account cumulative impacts, these impacts that are combined from different activities on the ocean, so the cumulative impacts of shipping, fishing, mining, and other activities all put together. So this is a map of these major regional organizations that manage high seas activities. If you instead only map the organizations that are able to comprehensively enact multi-sector conservation measures, the map looks a lot more like this. Very dramatic. And I should note that there are a few exceptions that are worth noting. So the first is in the Antarctic there. And that's where you have CAMLAR, the Commission for the Conservation of Antarctic Marine Living Resources. And they have, so CAMLAR is sort of a special snowflake case. Because most of these organizations we can classify as a regional fisheries management organization, which has management powers, and regional seas organization, which does not have management powers, but has this authority to, or rather this mandate to consider, you know, sort of conservation aspects. CAMLAR actually is a bit of both. It's some say it's technically a regional seas organization, but it has a lot of these characteristics of an RFMO in that it can.
Claire's going to fill us in on this.
Yes, and
right?
CAMLAR, I would like
yes.
to say, I'm contractually obligated to say CAMLAR is not an RFMO, it is
right.
a conservation.
Yes.
You did say that, but it is the objective of CAMLAR is the conservation of Antarctic marine living resources, where conservation includes rational use subject to the principles of Article 2 of the Convention.
And how effective are they in implementing this?
Well, it's better than before they had the convention and the Russians were just serially collapsing fish stocks, but are they living up to their obligations under the treaty? I would say not.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, which is worth noting because these sort of series of exceptions are often touted as, but look what these organizations can do. They're shining examples, and really when you actually dig into them, they're not what we want the BBNJ agreement to do, because if they are, then we're not reaching. So Antarctic with CAMLAR is one definite exception to this map. The Northeast Atlantic, which I'll get into a little bit more detail in institutional arrangements, is another exception. In this instance, you have the Regional Fisheries Management Organization, NAFC, Northeast Atlantic Fisheries Commission, overlapping exactly with the Regional Seas Organization of OSPAR, which just stands for the Oslo and Paris Conventions, in case you're into acronyms. And so they've actually done a lot of cooperating and coordinating together such that you have no fishing areas that overlap in some cases with the marine protected area that was established by OSPAR, but not all, and I'll have a map where you can sort of see that better in a few slides later. And then one other exception is the Mediterranean, where you have a similar example of having the RFMO and the RSO having exact overlap. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I think it's worth noting that enabling conditions exist in just these three exception areas. You have the Regional Seas Organization has a high seas jurisdiction. So there are many more regional seas organizations. They just don't have a mandate to cover the high seas. Okay, so it's just a small handful of them that do. Another enabling condition, you have the Regional Seas Organization and the RFMO have identical geographic boundaries. And then finally, a third enabling condition is that they have near identical member states. Great. These conditions don't really exist elsewhere in the ocean. So that's another issue when you have countries who say, oh, we can just follow these examples. Certainly lessons can be learned from these examples, but to think that they can be applied throughout the rest of the ocean, I think, is really challenging due to, I think, these lack of conditions that have been identified a bit. But the gaps extend more than just geographic gaps. There are certainly more important governance gaps as well. And I'm going to turn over to Kristina, who wrote the book.
Oh, no. There's many more people involved in this game, which is why it's so exciting to be here with all of you. Because we need as many brains in this puzzle as possible, because there's so many pieces to put together. That was David Freestone was the one who sort of elaborated what are the best practice governance principles that you can derive from the fish stocks agreement. Let's talk about precaution, ecosystem-based management from the CBD, science-based management, you know, all these good things that people have been agreeing to at Rio, but are not brought into any one place, and so there's a very ad hoc application of these principles. No mechanisms for coordination as to who is doing what where. There are now seabed mining exploration contracts atop areas closed to deep sea bottom fishing because of the rules for vulnerable marine ecosystems. Framework for the global network of MPAs. There's nothing that really provides the power, the criteria, or the mandate to designate and protect marine protected areas. Similarly with environmental impact assessments along the Sea Convention, sort of the overarching legal agreement has an explicit requirement for states shall assess potential impacts when it may cause serious and harmful effects, but because there's no explicit procedures to follow, you have very limited and sporadic implementation. The RFMO is for deep sea bottom fishing because the UN sat on top of them and said, no, you're not going to keep wiping out deep sea corals, you're going to assess whether they're actually there first before you allow bottom fishing. They do have a framework for EIAs, but many other activities do not. Strategic environmental assessments are a newer tool that are used often in embodied in the Convention on Biological Diversity to encourage governments to assess potential environmental consequences of programs, policies, actions, now used to assess the implications of sort of wind farms around Scotland or new technologies, new plans that really help you to have a more comprehensive view of what's going on. Limited capacity building technology transfer for developing countries. This is a critical part of the package of the Lawless Sea Convention in return for allowing states access to their exclusive economic zone for fishing, for shipping, for even cable laying. There was supposed to be a full program of capacity building technology transfer, and that has not happened yet. So this is an opportunity, again, to provide that enabling mechanism to make it so. Marine genetic resources have been, in many ways, the core impetus behind this agreement. The Convention on Biological Diversity is designed to address conservation, sustainable use, and then the fair and equitable benefit sharing of marine genetic resources. But that part only goes out to 200 nautical miles, doesn't address the issue of increasing use of genetic resources for pharmaceuticals, for cosmetics, and it doesn't have any mechanisms for even sharing the samples or sharing any potential financial proceeds, and this is where the developing countries really got to start on this discussion. And then, of course, uneven integration of biodiversity, your shipping regulations, every once in a while it's there, but not really consistently or efficient. Next.
All right. So the goal is for this new instrument, ultimately, is that we want to have a new BB&J instrument that can fill these gaps. And specifically with respect to ABMTs, we want to see a new instrument that's capable of establishing marine protected areas on the high seas, including associated management measures. And so to do that, we're going to switch gears now to the institutional arrangements section of this presentation.
Maybe any questions?
Oh, yes. We'll start. I'll pause for questions on ABMT specifically.
And you say, what are the institutional arrangements?
Great question, Kristina. So I think before doing it, I think it's important to couch the institutional arrangements discussion in this broader question of, you probably have heard if you read it all, global, hybrid, regional, right? What sort of framework should we be adopting? And on the floor of the PrepCom and of the IGC, there's you can see definite convergence among these three different sort of categories by different states and countries, regional groups as well. But I think it's a little bit more complicated because there's not a universal understanding of the exact definition of what we mean when we say global, what we mean when we say hybrid, what we mean when we say regional. And in fact, I would actually argue that it's more of a spectrum. And so on the one end of the spectrum, I think it's helpful to define sort of the two different ends of the spectrum. On the one end, you have the regional. And the regional model essentially represents the status quo.
Those who support it envision that the new instrument might provide maybe some additional guidance to parties, but that guidance would be very general, and all work and implementation would be done via existing sectoral and regional bodies. And under the regional, there's no vision that there would be no need for any sort of new COP or any sort of new body to carry out the work. On the other end of the spectrum, you have the global model, which envisions the new instrument establishing a new body with decision-making authority that would have the ability to fill governance gaps that I described earlier, and specifically that this body would be able to designate high seas MPAs. Might have guessed that this is the model that the High Seas Alliance is pushing for. And now somewhere in the middle is where the hybrid model falls. And I mean somewhere in the middle quite literally, because different countries sort of have a different scale, right? I think oftentimes when it's used, it's sort of seen as, well, this is the compromise between the global and the regional, right? But where people see this compromise being is really quite different. So to give a little bit more detail, I think those who support the hybrid model see the new instrument doing more than just providing general guidance, but it would fall short of actually having that decision-making authority that would enable the creation of marine protected areas. So they see that there would be a need for some sort of creation of a new body to have some sort of oversight, but its powers would be really limited, and they certainly wouldn't include the creation of marine protected areas. So that's sort of how I see this global hybrid regional question. I think very much related to this is this issue of not undermining. And so the question about undermining has also come up a lot. It's within the resolution establishing this IGC says that this new instrument shall not undermine existing institutions, instruments, etc. But then there's been a lot of debate as to what exactly we mean by the term not undermining. It's kind of an politically malleable term, and it's quite ambiguous. And so there's, again, a spectrum, I like to think. On the one end of the spectrum, you have those that see not undermining as meaning not overlapping. They believe, and then on the other end of the spectrum, you have those that think that not undermining means not weakening, not making less effective. So on the left side of the screen, so those who think not undermining means not overlapping, they say, well, we have regional fisheries management organizations, they manage fishing, so we don't need to consider fish at all in this new agreement. Existing organizations are enough. And that sort of closely aligns with the regional approach. So those countries that tend to have that understanding of not undermining also tend to align closer to the regional or sometimes the hybrid approach. On the other end of the spectrum, those that understand not undermining to mean not weakening, they do see these many gaps, and they think that this new treaty is necessary to fill these gaps, and they see a role for the BBNJ instrument to complement and to strengthen existing organizations. And so, again, those with this sort of interpretation tend to gravitate closer towards the global approach. And just because not undermining gets so much discussion during the negotiations that I'm going to segue just for this one slide to talk a little bit more about it. And I think, so there's a paper that Kristina and Harriet Harden-Davies and I wrote where we talk a little bit more about lessons that can be learned from the Fish Stocks Agreement, which is another implementing agreement to UNCLOS. And so it helpfully does actually use not undermining something like 15 times. And it's really, to me, I was so interested to learn that in every time that they use the term not undermining, it's with respect to the effectiveness of. So it's, states shall not shall ensure conservation measures for straddling fish stocks in the high seas do not undermine the effectiveness of measures adopted for the same stocks within the coastal states EEZ, and so on and so on. So I think that's a really helpful definition and a model for us to potentially be pushing for and adopting within the So
yes, to highlight the consistent with states parties powers to adopt stronger measures, which is really the core that a sovereign state has, that is not constrained by being a party to one of these organizations, but you have the powers to adopt measures over your own flag vessels, whether it's fishing, shipping, scientific research, or seabed mining.
Absolutely. Okay, back to institutional arrangements. And so I think it's really helpful just to talk about some of the components, what we're actually talking about when we mean institutional arrangements. The models is sort of how a global regional hybrid is sort of how it would interact with other bodies, but when we're actually talking about the BBNJ agreement, often sort of these components that we're looking at include, at a minimum, a conference of parties or some type of decision-making body. It's most often referred to as a conference of parties or a CALP, but it has other names as well. Many also brought support for some sort of a scientific body, and then a secretariat. So these are sort of the three common, and there were many states and even we see a need for other bodies as well, but I think these are sort of the three core central ones.
So it's implementation body,
these were
not a core one that's come up?
Well, no, not so much. I mean, it's one that we have certainly discussed within our MACs Alliance discussion, and nomenclature is, of course, another one that's come up as scientific body.
But actually, the CBD has gone to an implementation body. We often talk about a compliance body, which compliance body is the assumption that you've done bad things and therefore we're going to punish you. Whereas an implementation body might actually be a better way to frame it, which is we're here to help you better implement the agreement and oversee what's being done. So thank you.
Yeah. But yes, you're right. There are other sort of bodies, as I mentioned, compliance. I think probably only Duncan maybe has called it implementation body. And then, some financial, is there a subsidiary body that needs to be responsible for financing and budget and that type of thing? One that would oversee a clearinghouse mechanism, do you need a separate subsidiary body for that? So these are some additional ones, but these are core ones that you can see over and over again, especially within different state bodies' submissions. So then I'm just going to do a very quick analysis of these regional, hybrid, and global. So this is if you're interested in reading the whole thing, Pew has a sort of handout where we talk a little bit more about this analysis. But this is sort of in broad strokes what a regional model might look like. You have the new bottom, this does not show very well, does it at all? Anyway, but on the left, international agreement. So basically the BBNJ would just be a framework. There wouldn't be a body to carry out that work. It would provide general guidance to state parties. At most, it can have a reporting obligation. But in the end, implementation is uncertain under this model. And there are some real challenges that are associated with this model. And so there's, under the regional model, you're going to see a continuation of this imbalance between conservation and sustainable use, which I'll talk a bit more later. We've already discussed many times how the existing organizations have very limited mandates, little to no coordination, and that this ad hoc coordination that does happen is a really time-consuming process. So I'm going to go into detail on some of these points. But sufficient to say for now that existing organizations are not enough, and the regional model relies on existing organizations. In an ideal world, UNCLOS is attempting to achieve this balance between the conservation and the sustainable use of living resources. That's a really great idea. But unfortunately, the way that our governance models have been set up is heavily skewed towards the sustainable use side, and maybe really even more use. So on the conservation side, you have regional CEES organizations, but as Kristina has already mentioned, they actually don't have a mandate to manage any of the activities that affect those areas, so do we really even count them? And then a number of these organizations that focus on sustainable use don't do so great with the sustainable part of that, so it's really more use over there. And I think it's also worth noting here the example of NAF and OSPAR in the Northeast Atlantic. We were talking about that example earlier, where you do have this overlap where the regional CEES organization and the regional the RFMO have an overlap, and there's been coordination. They have an official memorandum of understanding, and they share a scientific body. So there's a lot of coordination that happens between these two bodies. And OSPAR, the Regional CEES Organization, identified marine protected areas, and I mentioned that NAOC, the RFMO, created fisheries closures. But if you look, the areas in red represent the RFMO, the Regional CEES Organization marine protected areas, And the areas in yellow represent the fisheries closures. So you can see that there's some overlap, but there are certainly areas that OSPAR identified as a marine protected area that don't benefit from any sort of fisheries closures on behalf of NAAFQ. And so again, this is another instance where, you know, this is a shining example of what we should try to strive to do, and yet this shining example is not functioning very well. And so I would just add that pause and caution to those who are touting it as an example we should be striving to achieve. So again, just looking to dig in a little bit to another key challenge, which is that coordination. And to really emphasize just the, how long it takes for this ad hoc coordination. So continuing on this NAAFQ example, they amended their mandate, they proposed amendments to their mandate in 2004. And they were actually pretty quick about it. They adopted those amendments just 2 years later in 2006. 2 years after that, they established the Memorandum of Understanding with OSPAR. A year later, they have an agreement to cooperate with the shipping organization, International Maritime Organization. And then in 2013, only, 7 years after the amendments were adopted, the amendments came into force. So again, all of this is to say that things take time. And I included the amendments bit, the amendment to the mandate here, because in almost all instances, if you were to ask existing organizations to carry out the work of BBNJ, it would require an amendment to the mandate. And NAAFQ is an example of one that went by really quickly. Other organizations, such as ICAT, has been working on an amendment to its mandate for over 10 years now with no end in sight. Speaking of ICAT, let's pick on them a little bit more. And in 2008, ICAT had a performance review where it was a glaringly terrible performance review of fisheries that's infamous in
an international disgrace.
Yes, thank you. They were called an international disgrace. And so they decided they needed to do something about that. For 3 years, they had the working group on the future of ICAT, which then led where the conclusion of which was that they needed to have an amendment to the convention, which has been meeting since 2013, but was really sort of instigated in 2009. So again, just to show coordination takes time.
Just elaborate here. Charlotte and I have been involved in the Sargasso Sea initiative, Sargasso Sea Alliance and the Sargasso Sea Commission. It sort of got its start around 2008. And we've been submitting papers to ICAT about the importance of the Sargasso Sea and then about the food chain of the Sargasso Sea. The Sargasso Sea, of course, is an EPSA. And each year, ICAT says, oh, well, thank you for the information. We need another 3 years to study it, and then we'll give you a conclusion. And their most recent conclusion was in 2015, they said, oh yes, Sargasso Sea is an important and unique area, but we need to identify what other areas in the Atlantic may be important and unique, and then we'll consider what measures may need to be taken.
Well, we can have a list, I think.
So it's just this continuous pushback from the governments that don't want to take on board conservation priorities.
Absolutely.
Similar tales in the app.
Yes, and we could go on, I'm sure, with many other examples of regional organizations trying to improve themselves. But we'll move on from the issues and challenges with the regional approach and switch gears a little bit to the hybrid approach. So this is just, I mentioned earlier that there are many different types of hybrid models. This is just a type of hybrid model that, again, is in that key product. If people are interested, I can circulate. And so under this hybrid model, we see that this new BBNJ agreement would create a decision-making body, and it would even have a scientific advisory body and a secretariat. However, they wouldn't be able to, again, they wouldn't be able to create marine protected areas. They wouldn't be able to create any sort of associated management measures with that. At best, they could recommend, some sort of specific measures, but it would be upon states parties to decide whether or not they actually took them. And how they would carry that out within other implementing organizations that they're also a party to. So again, in this instance, you have implementation is uncertain. And the main challenge with the hybrid approach is that it has no legal authority to adopt binding measures. In other words, it has no teeth. Which is why we chose the global approach. The approach that we're adopting, that the High Seas Alliance is supporting. Again, we have a decision-making body, scientific body, secretariat, but in this instance, we envision that this COP would be able to identify marine protected areas, associating management measures. Those measures would be binding once they were adopted on states' parties, then states' parties would also be obliged to try and, you know, and pursue complementary measures in other relevant bodies to which they are also a member. So again, we at least are seeing some sort of progress, some sort of actual possibility of having high seas marine protected areas. Now, I don't want to say that the global approach is without its challenges, because it certainly has some issues that we need to carefully consider. We need to consider under the global approach and to carefully think how we preserve and foster and effectively utilize existing regional expertise. We also need to ensure that we address how we use well-functioning regional organizations and cooperations so that they are supported and so that they can continue to thrive, because we certainly don't want to stymie organizations that are doing good work. And then another question that comes up over and over again when we talk about the global approach is, how do you avoid politicization? So how do you avoid having MPAs being used as some sort of political pawn in a greater game of political chess?
Claire can tell us for an hour about
yes,
that.
Yes, and I see the sadness in your eyes. So all of this to say, though, is that these challenges are not insurmountable, and they don't have to be, and they're not incompatible either with a global decision-making body. And these challenges are worth wrestling with, because there's a lot at stake. And again, because the state of our, so much at stake, depletion of fish stocks, degradation of the environment, ocean acidification, coral breaching, habitat destruction, plastic pollution, and the list could go on and on. And so in order to have effective marine protected areas in the high seas, we need to have an instrument that has some teeth. We need to have a global approach. To talk about a little bit more of the complexities of how this would work implementation, I'm going to turn over to Kristina for the rest of the presentation.
Oh, well, not the rest, just some questions. You've already sort of seen our view of, you have a conference of parties that's actually meeting, able to take decisions informed by the scientific committee, and that goes on to global direct implementation. But as Nichola was pointing out, you also need to empower and strengthen the regional organizations to do their job. So you're trying to figure out how to make sure that these regional sectoral organizations are actually doing their jobs. And one main tool is this global review and support through a implementation type body. Sort of some key elements that you would want to see in the agreement to help make this whole circle continue is a duty, pure and simple, to cooperate to establish marine protected areas and promote, who knows what an OECM is. Okay, anybody? Oh, okay, Ingrid.
Other effective conservation measure?
Area-based. Conservation measures.
Oh, is that's
it?
Yeah.
A
inside.
Oh, the AB's hiding. Silent.
Yeah.
The silent AB. Marino international.
It's actually French. It's French, so you don't pronounce that French.
Really so much. French was never my strong point. I know more Russian than French. That was promote institute conservation. So we're trying to build on what the Convention on Biological Diversity already initially has. But the Convention on Biological Diversity calls on states to cooperate and to apply the convention to the processes and activities under national jurisdiction and control, but does not explicitly apply to the components of biological diversity. And then they very niftily have a list of components of biodiversity, which are basically your seagrasses, your mangroves, your fish, your seals, everything that you really care about. So what we're trying to do is, in many ways, fill in the gaps of the Convention on Biological Diversity so that everything is actually covered. One of the things that the Law of the Sea Convention envisages, and the Fish Stocks Agreement does, is to develop a system of global standards, criteria, and guidelines to set global level priorities on what needs to be protected and how that can be done and how decision-making procedures should unfold. Fish Stocks Agreement talks about transparency, about participation, and it really did enable much more and cheaper participation by NGOs into the decision-making processes, and then prevent adverse effects. Just simply, that's part of your obligation as a state when you go to an RFMO, is to think through what are the consequences of your activities through EIAs, SEAs, and then to continue to report. These are just simply core obligations in the implementing agreement, because you can have all your nifty principles or ecosystem approach, but if there's nothing to actually review your assessment of, you have an empty agreement. There we go. And then just in terms of a view of how you actually get this thing done, the job done, is sort of direct top bottom on marine protected areas at the global level is their goal is long-term conservation. They're supposed to be comprehensive, address all threats. The agreement or the conference of parties can adopt global standards and guidelines. Perhaps you would like to adopt a global biodiversity strategy and action plan to build on the national ones that the CBD does, but then you also need a management plan for each MPA, which includes research, direct implementation, and then of course an ongoing process to assess how you're doing. The sectoral ABMTs, we've talked a lot about the process for an MPA establishment through the agreement, but we don't want to let our sectoral organizations off the hook so that they don't do the job they're actually supposed to be doing. So you can actually lay out some pretty nifty obligations in the implementing agreement on to update their mandates, to include conservation, and to make sure that their activities are sustainable, address specific sector-related threats, so they're actually using their area-based management tools to address bycatch or to address habitat. And again, developing biodiversity strategies and action plans, the International Maritime Organization could, when it's looking at SDG 14, sort of say, oh, what do we do to lighten our footprint on the marine environment? And then this is, I won't call it the hybrid approach, but it's actually relying on states' parties to the agreement than going into the sectoral organizations and getting as many people on board or implementing directly themselves. And then, of course, your principles are absolutely vital against your something to implement on. And then just recognizing that you also want to encourage regional processes. CAMLR, Antarctic Convention, you don't want them to stop doing, hopefully, good things, but you still need this sort of global review and support and getting states' parties, if they're a party to CAMLR, to come back to New York and say, ooh, we didn't quite manage to get this one adopted because, oh, well, I wanted more research money, or I didn't want them to declare an MPA in my part of the gyre. That was, that's encouraging them to continue on, and then you can get them endorsed and applied by more. And more of us, I think Maria Malia could speak to it, are looking at sort of wider spatial planning and management. Mm-hmm. You can't have a marine protected area everywhere you would like it to be or as big as you would like it to be, but you may have harmful activities going through your area that if you could actually redirect the ships going through, you could reduce the chance of ship strikes, reduce the possibilities for noise, reduce the fact that they're mining on top of your closed area. So it's a logical process to complement marine protected areas to make sure you have complementary measures on the outside. And then just trying to combine it all into one package. And I'm of course interested in all the crazy, weird looking creatures in the mesopelagic, the waters between 200 and 1,000 meters, and then they're even weirder below. 70% of these guys depend on bioluminescence to communicate, to find their prey, to find their mates. And they also have to be transparent in order to get their job done. So you need to both give off light as well as to suck it in. This is basically the importance of transparency and global level review, building on through so that people are aware of who's doing what where and how the food chain is actually moving forward. So I think we've gone on. And if you come down to Monterey, where some of us will be in January, you get to see the humpback whales breaching for yourselves. That was, okay. You get to finish.
Sure.
She gets the last word.
Okay, which is just to say that we need high seas and MPAs to affect meaningful and positive change in the world's ocean. To do that, we need a strong tree global decision-making body.